Good evening, everyone. I would like to start this fifth session of the webinar being conducted by CENTA. Welcome to all of you. And this particular session is being conducted by our own CEO and founder, Ramya Venkatraman. So, and the session, as you all are aware of, is on effective coaching in a school environment. So I would request Ramya to start the session and hope all of you would enjoy the session. Over to you, Ramya.
Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, Samir, you're audible.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes. We can hear you.
Yes.
Okay. So, yes. Also request everyone to put yourselves on mute, as Priyanka already said. We will interact in other ways, but given that it's a largish group today, we will not be interacting so much through voice, but we'll interact in other forms. So firstly, I hope everyone can see my screen, which currently just has the title of the presentation. Today's session is on effective coaching in a school environment. And while everyone is welcome to join, it's a workshop very specifically for principals, coordinators, and others who coach teachers as part of their role. And as some of you might be aware, CENTA Standards, which is our competency framework for teachers, has coaching as a very important competency in level 3. And when we certify senior teachers as well as coordinators, principals, etc., on level 3 competencies, coaching is one of the important competencies that we look at, and today's session is focused entirely on coaching. So to begin with, I'm going to request, so majority of this is going to be an exercise, not a lecture. So to begin with, I'm going to request everyone to go to www.menti.com. Menti spelled as M-E-N-T-I. menti.com. You can do it on the same device from where you are joining this call or on a different device. It doesn't matter. And once you go to menti.com, please enter the code 264582. The code again is 264582. And we are also putting the same thing on the chat. In case anyone is unclear, yeah, so the code is 264582, and the website is www.menti.com. There were a few people, I think, who are unable to see my presentation. It is okay. For now, it doesn't matter. You can just go to menti.com and enter this code. Can a few people type yes if you have been able to enter the code on menti.com? Okay, great. So several people have done that already. So what you're going to see now is a series of 8 questions. We'll present one by one, 8 questions. These are 8 different situations, and there are 4 options for you to choose from. Now, please note that this is not a CENTA test. So it is not our teaching quotient or teaching professionals Olympiad, which means that there is no right or wrong answer. Please select what you think you will do in the particular situation. So it's not a test. Please select what you think you will do in the particular situation. And even if you feel that you may do more than one of the 4 things, please force yourself to pick only one option. So force yourself to pick the closest option, keeping in mind the situation, based on what you think you will do in that situation. So not what you think is right or wrong or what somebody else should do, but what you think you will do. So if that is clear, we'll go to the exercise right away. You will see the question on menti.com very soon.
Okay.
So you will see the question on menti.com. I will anyway just read it out for convenience. So the first situation, you are the principal. You have a middle school coordinator who was always doing a great job so far, but he now seems to be intimidated by a brilliant new teacher who is always bubbling with ideas. And you find that the coordinator's efforts have dropped a lot. So the situation is that you are a principal, your middle school coordinator who was always doing a great job so far, now seems to be intimidated by a brilliant new teacher who is always bubbling with ideas, and you find that the coordinator's efforts have dropped a lot. You have four options in terms of what you may do. One, take the coordinator out for lunch, show support, listen to him and reassure him. Two, explain the importance of the coordinator's role and enroll him for high quality professional development. Three, do nothing, the problem will sort itself out. Four, make a detailed list of areas where the coordinator needs to contribute and create a weekly plan for him. So these are the four options. As I said, force yourself to select only one, and you need to press submit after selecting. Only if you press submit, your answer will be taken in. So we are finding that 100 people have already answered, which is fantastic. We currently have close to 200 people on the call. When about maybe another, we'll give another 2 minutes since it's also the first question. So just a quick check with my colleague Karthik. Can you see my screen?
No,
we can see you.
We can see you, not your screen.
Okay, because I think somebody else clicked on presenting. Okay, let me just... I'm just sharing my screen again. You should be able to see it now. Can you see my screen now?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yes, now we can see.
Okay, great. So, So we already have a lot of people who have voted on the first question, and we are going to close the voting now and move to the second question. So the second question or the second situation is you are the principal again, and you have started online classes for your school. I'm sure many of you are facing a situation like this right now. So you have started online classes for your school. One of your best teachers is completely unfamiliar with technology. And after her first video class went badly, she said online teaching doesn't work, and now she's often late for class, she skips your planning meetings, etc. So you're the principal, one of your best teachers is completely unfamiliar with technology, her first video class went badly, after that she said online teaching doesn't work, and now she's often late for her class, skips your planning meetings, etc. What would you do? Option one, do nothing. She will recover from the disappointment of her first video class and do better. Option two, have a personal phone call with her, express your support, encourage her so that she feels more motivated. Option three, help her plan her lessons in detail, including technology aspects, join some of her online classes and give feedback regularly. And option four, explain to her the overall approach of online teaching and let her develop her own plans and decide which technology she wants to use. So once again, please force yourself to choose one option and press submit after selecting. We already have 80 people who have, or 90 people who have responded. We'll wait for a couple of more minutes for others to respond. Yeah, so we have a pretty large number of responses. So I think we will move on. Okay, a few more coming in. I'll just give a few more seconds. Okay, so we'll move on to the next question now. Situation 3 of 8. In this situation, you are a teacher. Your principal gives you very valuable input whenever he observes your class, but he visits your class so rarely and often does not visit even when requested that you feel that you're not getting enough guidance. So you are a teacher, your principal gives you very valuable input whenever he observes your class, but it's really rare. Even when you request him to visit, he doesn't. And so you feel you're not getting enough guidance from your principal. What will you do as the teacher? Option one, wait and watch. Your principal may have an overall plan in mind. Option two, explain to him what kind of input would be most useful for you during the next class observation. Option three, create a visit plan and observation rubric and ask your principal if he would be willing to follow those. Option four, speak with the principal informally about his role, any constraints that he is facing, etc. So these are the four options. Please force yourself to select one, press submit. And we have some 60 people who have already responded. 85 now. Yeah, more than 100 responses now. We'll wait for another minute. Okay, so we'll move to the fourth situation. Fourth situation, you are the math department head. A very good and committed math teacher is struggling to use a new math teaching software. So you are the head of the department, and one of your teachers, who is very good, very committed, is struggling to use a new software. What will you do? Have a conversation and tell him that he is a very good teacher and will learn this new software also easily. Option two, do nothing. He will learn on his own. Option three, give him detailed lesson plans for upcoming topics which incorporate the software so that he can run the classes easily. Option four, set up an expert session for him to understand the software properly so that he can plan his lessons after that. So these are the four options. Please choose your preferred option. Click on submit. Great to see the group speeding up, and we are already at 100 responses. So for anyone who joined late, you need to go to www.menti.com, click and enter the code which is there on the chat box in the Google Hangout. That is 264582. So you need to enter the code there, and you can vote on whichever question is going on at this time. So even if you have missed a couple of questions, it's okay. Please vote on the remaining ones. I'm also noticing that a lot of people are putting their votes in the chat. At least some people have put it. I would request everyone to, as much as possible, put your votes in Mentimeter, only because it'll just make the remaining part of the session more interesting. So as much as possible, please put your votes in Mentimeter. So we are done with the fourth situation. We've had a large number of votes this time. We will move to situation five. Situation five, you are the principal. Your two senior teachers are extremely good in the classroom, well-liked by everyone, and get along with each other very well. So you have two senior teachers in your school who are extremely good, well-liked, get along well with each other. Recently, in a meeting, they disagreed openly and heatedly on the use of certain assessments. What will you do as the principal? Option one, do nothing, let them sort it out themselves. Option two, coach each of them separately on how such an issue should be resolved and check in after a week. Option three, call both of them together and tell them exactly how this disagreement needs to be resolved. Option four, call both of them together and act as a mentor or facilitator while they discuss the issue amicably. So once again, please force yourself to select one option, click on submit after voting. And we have close to 100 options already, 100 votes already. We'll give another minute and move to the next situation. Okay, we will move to the next situation now. So the sixth situation, total of eight, we are on the sixth situation. A college student is interning as an assistant teacher in your school every weekend. He has no teaching background. Over time, you find that his commitment level is also low, and he's probably only interested in quoting this experience in his resume. So a college student is interning as an assistant teacher in your school, has no teaching background, and over time you find that he's also not committed. What will you do? Option one, ask him about his concerns and listen to him fully. Option two, have a straight conversation on expectations from an intern and give him a clear list of tasks and guidelines. Option three, set up a few sessions where he can observe senior teachers so that he understands better how to teach. Option four, wait and watch. This may be a temporary phase. So again, select one option, press submit. And we have about 100 votes already. So it's wonderful that the first 100 people finish voting even before I read out the question, so that's great. We'll give it another half a minute, move to the next question. Okay, we will move to situation seven now. You are the principal. Once again, you need to start online classes. So we thought we should devote at least two of the eight situations to online classes, which are a top of mind concern for a lot of people right now. So you as the principal need to start online classes. One of your very good teachers has worked in a technology company before. She offers to create a simple toolkit that all teachers can start using in a week. So you're the principal, you need to start online classes. One of your very good teachers who has technology background offers to create a simple toolkit for all your teachers. Option one, discuss. So what will you do as the principal? Option one, discuss her idea in detail, plan the toolkit creation step by step, and do a daily check-in. Option two, agree and give her the responsibility to create the toolkit, set up a check-in in a week. Option three, appreciate her initiative and tell her that the toolkit could be considered another time after consulting all the teachers. Option four, explain to her what aspects are important in online teaching and ask her to build her toolkit based on these aspects. So these are the four options. Please select one, press submit. More than 100 responses already. Okay, so a lot of people have voted. We will now move to, okay, we just give it another few seconds till some votes coming in. Okay, we'll move to the last situation for this session, and after this the discussion will start. So the last situation is that you are the principal again. The students need to perform a musical. Your young science teacher, who is great in her classes, is keen to direct the musical. She assures you that she can handle it fully, though she has never done anything like this before. So the situation is that the students of the school need to perform a musical. Say you have an annual day or something coming up where they need to perform a musical. You have a young science teacher who is great in her classes, and she is keen to direct the musical. She assures you that she can handle it, even though she has not done anything like that before. What will you do as the principal? Option one, give her the assignment and tell her regularly that you have full confidence in her so that she continues to feel motivated. Option two, give her step-by-step instructions on how to plan the musical and monitor her progress closely on each task. Option three, coach her on the overall approach for the musical, agree on the broad theme, and agree to discuss progress in a couple of weeks. Option four, let her handle the musical on her own. After all, she is a great teacher. So these are the four options. Please select one. Click on submit after you select. Okay, we have quite a few responses that have already come in. Okay, I think most people have finished voting. So firstly, I hope everyone enjoyed thinking about the situations, and maybe we can just get a quick round of reactions on the chat on what you felt about the situations themselves. How was the experience of answering these situations? Glad to know that many of you found the situations relatable to what you have seen in your own schools, and also glad to know that you found the situations to be interesting. I also realize that some of you may not have been able to vote on all of them, either because you know, you were there for only a part of it, or because you because the voting moved on before you finished. But the whole webinar will be available for viewing. And a few people have asked what approaches would be good in each of the different scenarios. And that is exactly what we are going to discuss right now. What, not exactly what approach will work in that particular scenario, but what is an appropriate way to think about this. Sorry, someone is saying I'm not audible. I'll just ask Karthik for a check. Am I audible?
Yes, Ramya, you are audible.
Okay.
You
okay.
are.
Okay, great. So I'm going to share my screen once again now. And what I'm going to request everyone to do is think about how you decided which option to choose. So we are not asking what option did you choose, because obviously each situation was different, but on what basis did you decide which option to choose? And what I would like is for everyone to type a word or phrase in the webinar chat which captures why you chose various options. You can type any number of words or phrases. So please type a word or phrase capturing why you chose whatever option you chose. Okay, so just can I just request everyone to maybe wait for a minute. Just wait for a minute before you continue typing. A few people have said we chose the option based on effectiveness and success. What I would suggest is go to the next level of detail. So effectiveness and success is what all of us are looking for. But go to the next level of detail. So somebody said, I tried to put myself in that situation. Somebody said personal experience. So let's hear a few more reasons for why you chose a particular option. I'm just trying to capture as many words as possible. So I'm not capturing what is repeated, but I'm trying to capture as many different words as possible. I'm also not capturing something like keeping wider interest of student learning in mind, because that I'm assuming is an overall goal that all of us have. So capturing next level things. So you can see my slide. Somebody has said situations that allow or options that allow professional development of the teacher. Somebody has said options that where I empathize with the person. It's based on the maturity level of the team member. I choose the most encouraging option based on personal experience, tried to put myself in that situation. And actually the personal experience came up, my rough guess is at least 20 people said that. I'm just saying into 20, and tried to put myself in that situation. My rough guess is that at least 10 people said that. I'm just putting into 10. Let's see what else is there. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so wonderful to see the many different perspectives that that people are bringing. I'm just capturing a few more which are a bit different. Okay. I think we will move from this chat. So thank you very much for sharing your inputs, everyone. I may not have been able to capture everything, but I tried to capture as many of the different options as I could. And what I want to show you here, I guess you can see my screen again, Karthik.
Yes, Ramya.
Okay, great.
We can see the screen. Yeah.
So if you see my screen, all the different reasons that all of you gave on with respect to why you chose a particular option, you can broadly categorize it in three categories. One is what we say, what we call the skill level of the coachee. And I'm using the word coachee for whoever the person is whom you're trying to coach. And very often this might be a subordinate, but it doesn't have to be. So for example, in the situation where you are the teacher and the principal is not visiting your class very often, the principal is the coachee. So it doesn't matter that it is your boss. So the skill level of the coachee is one category. And there were a couple of answers in the chat where someone said that I will choose something that allows for professional development of the teacher. So I'm sort of assuming that indirectly they are talking about the skill level. Somebody said I'll keep the teacher's aptitude in mind, and aptitude is also related to skill level. The second category is what we call the will level of the coachee. So somebody said, I will try to, somebody is not on mute. Can I request everyone to be on mute? Yeah, thank you. So somebody said that I will empathize with the person, and that indirectly refers to what is the person's will level, referred to maturity level, which is part of will broadly. Somebody said, I will pick the most encouraging option, which indirectly influences the will level of the coachee. Somebody said, I will pick an option that allows conflict resolution, again, indirectly influences will, or builds self-confidence, indirectly influences will. So this is the second category. Now, interestingly, even though I captured only a few dot points, if I had really tried to put the put your chat responses on a graph, you will find that the majority of the responses were in the third column, which is at least 20 people said personal experience, maybe more. At least 10 people said tried to put myself in the situation. A lot of people said what I have seen others doing. A lot of people said seen similar situations before. Now, all of these broadly feed into what we call your own preferences. Now, yes, as a coach, your own preference in coaching plays a very important role. Having said that, the general norm to keep in mind, just like this page is structured, is that two-thirds of your approach, or even 80% of your approach, should be based on the coachee, whereas only 20% or 30% of your approach should be based on your own preference, which includes your own past experience, other situations that you've seen, whether you generally prefer to encourage, generally prefer to resolve conflict, etc., etc. So the more you can shift your coaching focus to what the particular coachee in that particular situation needs and base your options on that, the more effective coaching can be. So would suggest to everyone to keep this rough percentage in mind. Like this page, two-thirds or 80% should be based on the coachee, and less than a third based on your own preference. And with respect to the coachee, someone called Max Landsberg has come up with a simple framework on how to think about the coachee. And we'll just go through that framework for a few minutes before we come back to your voting responses. So this framework is called the Skill Will Matrix. Some of you might have heard of it. It was developed by Max Landsberg and introduced in his book called The Tao of Coaching, a very good book. Now, on one axis is the will of the coachee for that particular task or that particular competency. And when we say will, we are talking about interest, confidence, incentives, security, your personal comfort in doing something, your desire to achieve something, etc. And will varies based on the task. So if you ask me what was my level of interest in organizing this webinar today, I was very interested. So I had high will to do it. But if you ask me what is my level of will in, let's say, exercising in the morning, my will is rather low. So it is not common for all tasks, for all of us. Each of us will have high will for something and high will for and low will for something else. Similarly, coming to skill, you will see that skill is based on what is the refers to things like what is the competency of the person, which could be tested by certain independent tests, or it could be based on the educational qualifications of the person, it could be based on prior work experience of the person, it could be based on your own observation of the person's skill. But net-net, it refers to what is the competency the person has for the particular task. And again, skill differs a lot based on what task we are talking about. So for example, if you ask me to create an Excel sheet, I'm very skilled at it. If you ask me to swim, I don't know how to swim at all. So my skill on that is very low. So skill varies from task to task. Will also varies from task to task. It also varies from time to time. So for example, today morning, I may have had low will to exercise, but maybe yesterday morning, my will to exercise was better. So both skill and will, or today, you know, I may not know how to create a PowerPoint, but 1 month down the line, I may have learned how to create one. So both skill and will vary by task and vary by time for the same person. Now, based on this, you can look at four quadrants: a low skill, low will quadrant, a low skill, high will quadrant, a low will, high skill quadrant, and a high skill, high will quadrant. Now, let's get back to the Google chat for a minute. And I'm just going to stop sharing my screen for a minute and ask everyone. So if somebody for a particular task at a particular point in time has low will and low skill, what will your approach be? And separately, I'm just noting Vidya's comment or question, which is will overrides skill or not. I will pick this up. It's a common question that comes up in this workshop. I will pick this up after this discussion. So if somebody is low skill, low will on a particular task at a particular point in time, Can we have a few people type, what would you do to coach them? Low skill, low will quadrant. Okay, Priya Dixit says, give direct instructions. Great. Okay, in the interest of time, I'm just going to keep moving. So thank you, Priya. That is what Max Landsberg also says, which is give direct instructions if somebody has low skill and low will. Now, let me move to the second quadrant. If somebody has low skill but high will, so they are very keen, very interested, but they don't know what to do, what will you do? Coach, train. Yeah, so a lot of you have said coach, train, guide, and of course the word coaching we are using a little more broadly here for all the approaches together, but let's use the word train, guide, skill development, professional development. So these are, I think many of you are saying that, instruct. So these are classic approaches for people when they have low skill but high will on something. And please note that they are already high in will. So motivating them is not useful because they are motivated, but they simply don't know how to do that particular thing. So however much you motivate me, I cannot start swimming till I learn how to swim. So so when there is low skill, high will, as many of you have pointed out, we need to train and we need to provide the right resources, provide professional development, etc. Now, what about high skill, low will? So I'm very skilled at something, let's say. Yeah, okay. Many of you, Jaypriya, Balaji, Anita Raman, many of you have mentioned motivate, encourage, give incentives, counsel, appreciate, set timelines, find out what interests them. Great. So I think all of you have expressed it very nicely. Reward. So yes, somebody is skilled and but has low will. How do we support, motivate, and reward, recognize, incentivize, build encouragement, etc.? Let's come to the fourth quadrant. Somebody is very high skilled, very high willed at a particular thing. What will you do? Yep, Pearl Lobo says give them complex tasks. KV Hema says delegate. Somebody says that's an asset. Give greater responsibilities. Make full use. Make them a mentor for others. Fantastic. So what a lot of you are saying is that this is an asset for your team. So somebody who is very high skilled, very high will on something, they are an asset. So give them challenging tasks, delegate, let them be, let them do their own thing. Okay, so let's go back to the presentation. Yeah, somebody says allow them to experiment. Somebody says extract maximum work from them. You're clearly a hard taskmaster. Just joking. Let's go back to the screen. Okay. So what Max Landsberg says is when somebody is low-skilled, low-willed at a particular task, at a particular point in time, use the approach called direct or directing, which is specific direction, frequent supervision, clear expectations and deliverables, strong control. So we use the word micromanage. So yes, micromanage when somebody is low-skilled, low-willed at something. Now, when the person is low-skilled but high-willed, provide training, use direction setting, use problem structuring, and with their will, they will be able to move forward. when somebody is high skilled but low will, encourage, offer personal support, offer reward and recognition, and with their skill, they will be able to then move forward. And finally, when somebody is high-skilled, high-willed on something, give responsibility, allow innovation. As a leader, take the risk, which means that once you've delegated to them and they, let's say, make a mistake, then as a leader, be prepared to say, you know, I'm behind you. It doesn't matter that there was a mistake. I'm still behind you on this. And we have taken this decision very consciously. So somebody asked, does will override skill or, you know, does one come before the other? Frankly, from my personal experience, and I'm sure, you know, there'll be a lot of people around this call who have a lot of experience on this whole topic. But at least, you know, for what it's worth, from my personal experience, I have actually seen both sides of this. So I have seen people who are in the bottom right quadrant, that is, they have high skill but low will, and people who are in the top left, which is that they have high will but low skill. And it is not clear to me that so the way will can override skill is if training is available. So if somebody is very high-willed on something and training is available, then yes, that will can allow them to move. But having said that, what often happens is that we don't end up providing that right training, or we don't end up providing training on the particular skill. It becomes a training which is more general for all the teachers of the school, and this particular person's need is not really addressed. And over a period of time, that will can actually drop. And the same goes the other way around. So somebody might be very high skilled and you think, okay, you know, he knows this, why is he not doing it? But without offering the right encouragement, the right reward, recognition, the person is not willing to move forward. And over a period of time, a skill which is not used can deteriorate. So net-net, people could be taking either of these two routes towards delegate, which is that they could be first improving their skill and then becoming more willed on a particular thing, or they could be first improving their, they could be first getting more motivation to do it and then getting trained. So both routes are possible. The important thing for you as a leader is to recognize whether the person is in the bottom right corner, which is the support corner, or the top left corner, which is the train corner. So very often you will find that we as leaders mix between the two things. And when someone actually needs support, we end up giving them more training on something that they already know. Or when someone actually requires training, we end up giving them more motivation and support. Whereas all they're asking is, you know, just tell me how to do this. So the goal of coaching is to move people towards the delegate corner from wherever they are starting. So they could be starting from any of the four quadrants at that point. And once again, I want to reiterate that this is not for the person as a whole. So if anyone goes back from this session and says, oh, this person is a low skill, high will person, I would say that the session has been a failure. So this is for a particular competency at a particular point in time. So it's not for the person as a whole, not meant for branding anyone, but it's simply for that specific competency at that specific point in time. And the best way to understand this star that you see in the middle, the best way to understand this is to actually put down for yourself which competency falls for yourself in each of the four quadrants. So what are you low skill, low will at? What are you low skill, high will at? What are you high skill, low will at? And what are you high skill, high will at? And once you put that down, I think you will start recognizing that this is not a person as a whole, but a particular competency at a particular point in time. And all of coaching refers to that. So going back to this, so as I said, the goal of coaching is to delegate and to see whether to see whether you can move as many of your team members as possible towards the delegate quadrant, where they become assets for you. And with that, I'm actually going to pause for a minute to get the results of the voting that all of us did. And Priyanka, are we ready with the slide of the results?
Yeah, Rama, I'll just share.
Okay, I'll just stop sharing my screen so that you can share. Yeah.
Ramya, are you able to see my screen?
Yeah, I'm able to see your screen. I hope everyone's able to see Priyanka's screen. So we had an equal number of situations. Let me just take you through this matrix. It is actually quite interesting. We have an equal number of situations in the four quadrants. So out of the eight situations, we had two which were in the high skill, high will quadrant, two in the high skill, low will, two in the low skill, high will, and two in the low skill, low will quadrant. So ideally, you will realize that there should be numbers only in the green diagonal, equal numbers in the green diagonal, with everything else as zero. That would be the textbook answer, so to say. And as I said right in the beginning, there's no right or wrong answer here. It's only giving us a view of our own preferences, our own biases. Now, there are a few interesting things you can see in this. One is with respect to delegating, which, by the way, this is the, I think it's the sixth time that I'm running this workshop, and mostly with groups of principals. And invariably, the delegating column has the lowest score. And at least my interpretation of that is that as a school leader, the level of commitment to what you're doing and to your students tends to be so high that you feel like you have to get everything perfectly right. And that in turn often means that you end up delegating much less than what you could have done, which in turn means that your schedule is extremely crowded. And the people who need directing, training, supporting are probably getting less than they would have. And by the way, please note that we might have had different number of votes for every question, but that's been normalized by Priyanka. So we've taken it as equal number of votes for all questions. So the delegating clearly shows that this group as a whole doesn't have a preference towards that. So a very interesting situation in the high skill, high will quadrant was regarding the two teachers who were arguing with each other on a particular form of assessment. And the situation said very clearly that they are great in their classroom, well-liked by everyone, get along very well with each other. And I think majority of the people did not vote for let them sort it out. So as a school leader or as a coordinator, the question to yourself is, why get in the middle of them? Why would you not just let them sort it out? Somebody's asked, can personal matrix be provided? Unfortunately, the votes are anonymous, so we kept it that way so that everyone is comfortable voting. So the votes are completely anonymous, so we don't know what you voted. The questions, of course, are the results are based on everyone's responses, so they are not based on. So Gajanan, you're right. They are based on everyone's responses. They are not based on one person's responses. And and the webinar as a whole is will be available. So you can see the questions and think of your own responses later. So this is one observation. The second very interesting observation, which again I come across quite a lot in the education sector, is that as people in the sector, we have a bias in favor of training. So very often we end up providing training even to someone who actually needs something else, like maybe reward, recognition, motivation, etc. And we end up saying, you know, let us organize a training program for you. Whereas the person is actually skilled at that particular thing. And as long as there was an appropriate reward, the person might actually perform fine. And yes, as Principal N.H. Goel has said, yeah, a lot of training happens which may not be effective. And one of many reasons why training is not effective is that the person did not require that training in the first place, because they already were skilled on the particular thing. Interestingly, we of course have an average number for both directing and supporting. Supporting is relatively low for the. So again, if you see, we have tried to support the. So look at the supporting column now. We have tried to support the high-skilled, high-willed people, whereas the people who had a will issue, we are not supporting them enough. So if the time you spent on that 80 could just be reallocated to the 25, you would have met both purposes. So the high-skilled, high-willed people could have just been left alone, and the high-skilled, low-willed situations could have been supported. And someone refers to the question pertaining to online classes. So yeah, that's an interesting question, which I also wanted to touch upon as an example of the broader principle. So there were two questions on online classes. One was referring to a teacher who was very good at technology and a very good teacher. This was, by the way, the other question on delegation. So where you know, you could have just left it to the teacher to create the toolkit for the rest of the school. The person is a good teacher, the person is good at technology, there is no need to manage the person anymore. On the other hand, the teacher who was very uncomfortable with technology, and after the first lesson did not go well, she also lost her motivation. That was an example of where a directive approach could work much more. I think many of you may have chosen directive there, we don't know. So this is the gist of what you voted for. I just want to do a last conclusion for another 2 minutes. And then if people want to stay on for 10 minutes, we can take more questions. But Priyanka, can you stop presenting? Yeah, I'm just going to present my screen again. So a last concluding remark, which is practically how do you implement the skill will matrix? So first step, determine the skill of the coachee for that particular competency at that particular point in time. Determine will similarly. Adjust your coaching approach based on that. Where skill is low, ensure personalized, targeted, needs-based training. And where will is low, motivate or encourage and set up appropriate career path and reward structures. And also want to mention that as center, since our primary commitment is to teachers and to the development of teachers, there are three parts of this where we try to play a role. So one is in the determining the skill itself, where we run something called Center Teaching Quotient Test, which, you know, many of you might be aware of. It is a test which can be done anytime from anywhere and gives a nationally benchmarked score on specific sets of competencies. Second is this aspect of personalized, targeted, needs-based training, which we are trying to support more and more through the MyCenter platform, which is where you also registered for this webinar. And the third is the career path and reward structures, which is, of course, our fundamental mission as Center, that teachers should start having more rewarding aspirational careers. And we support schools in planning that in a structured manner. So I just wanted to mention that as additional context. Also want to mention another interesting development, just an announcement at our end before we take questions, and I'm stopping the screen sharing now, which is that we have partnered with Manipal Group and Manipal University to launch two postgraduate certificate programs, one for teachers and one for principals. So both of these are programs starting in September, and admissions will be starting soon. So these will be fully online programs, though there will also be options for in-person support. And Centa and Manipal University are very glad to be partnering on this. I know we also have someone from Manipal on this session. And very glad that we are doing this together. We'll be releasing a more formal announcement soon, but just wanted to mention that while all of you are here. So finally, if anyone wants to stay for another 5-10 minutes, we can take any questions or comments. Yeah, and thank you everyone for participating so enthusiastically. I think wonderful to see how you voted and how you gave inputs on the chat. So thank you very much for that. I think since there aren't any more questions, we can wrap up now. Thank you very much.